Children react to abuse of all forms, normally, and especially to abuse of the letter kind, idolizing, putting on a pedestal. They feel that they have become objects. They feel that they are extensions of the parents, objectified, dehumanized, and they rebel. The vast majority of children go through this phase unscathed and unharmed, and they end up being leading totally normal lives, unaffected by the abuse. Some children, though, develop mental health problems in reaction to the abuse. These children probably have a genetic predisposition to developing mental health problems, but one of the most common reactions to abuse is narcissism, and another common reaction is codependence.
Boxes are getting built, they look so cool.
It's getting filmed now, and I'm in
the
Subway.
This is not sponsored by Subway.
Not at all.
We'll take them as a sponsor, can't we?
Or Volvic.
Or Jamfix.
Eat fresh. I've met Gabby, I knew her since the early days of college. She was in the year above me. It was that sort of thing, like her year was sort of the year that I sort of looked up to with some of the stuff that they were doing, and her ideas in particular. I've done a few things with her now, and she's so creative. Every time that she asks me or if she tells me something going on, I feel just honored to actually do it with her, because I know I'm in capable hands when she's working on the scene and when she's plotting everything out. And she's also just a blast to act with as well.
You're doing all sorts of different. Oh, fuck you.
Tell me you're going on. Yes!
You're doing all sorts of different.
Oh, fuck you.
Fucking bastard.
So, can you tell us about some of the themes that comes up in the play?
Some of the themes that come up in the play are domestic abuse. Focuses more on more the mental aspect of domestic abuse as opposed to the physical aspect of it. Very, very dark.
Narcissist lacks the ability to relate. Narcissists don't have empathy. So it's very, very difficult for the narcissist to understand truly, insightfully, what it means to be human. What goes through other people's minds. He misinterprets behavior, body language, social cues. He disastrously misreads other people's intentions, hopes, fears, needs, and so on and so forth. So in this sense, narcissism is a bit like Asperger disorder, like autism. Oh, you took what you wanted to take, and yet you never wanted nothing from me. The narcissists imitate normal human beings. It's very, very much what we are doing today with artificial intelligence. And we are teaching machines to imitate human beings. We are teaching how to behave so that they imitate human beings. And narcissists are doing this naturally. Modern culture, let's say in the last 250 years, tried very hard to humanize the monster. So we have the Hunchback of Notre Dame, you know, he was in love. And so he's a kind of a human monster, humanized monster. Suddenly you begin to feel empathy and compassion for the Hunchback of Notre Dame. Even though if you look at his acts objectively, he kidnapped and threatened to kill a woman. And modern culture has used it to good advantage. So we have numerous stories about the Beauty and the Beast, you know, we have numerous stories about monsters that are actually deep inside, you know, not so monsters. And if you just get to know them, everything, I mean, you will grow to love them and they want to love. So why don't you ignore their exterior and also ignore all the horrible things they are doing, like kidnapping and killing and so on, and just grow to love them? Of course, it's a message, a narcissistic message in effect, orchestrated by narcissistic studio bosses and narcissistic authors and so on and so forth. And it's an insidious form of propaganda.
a law in England and Wales was passed on coercive control, meaning that perpetrators can now be imprisoned for up to 5 years and face a fine as well. But in Scotland, there still hasn't been a law passed. It has been discussed in Parliament, and it does look like the bill will go through. So it is getting there, it's taking its time, but it's getting there. And this play is just keeping that awareness alive. A lot of people link abuse to physical abuse, bruises, cuts, that kind of thing. And of course that is domestic abuse, but being controlled financially, sexually, or being isolated, or being made to feel like you're worthless gradually over a long period of time, that is 100% domestic abuse, and it can't be tolerated. I started researching the play with women who had experienced psychological abuse and coercive control. I found it important to get people's stories, these sort of lived legacies, these stories that could have been lost. I found it personally really important to make sure these women's voices were heard, and they were very keen to be a part of the project and to have their story told. But I also wanted to get a balanced approach, and I wanted to speak with Sam to try and understand the sort of mindset of a person who behaves like this. Sam's a very unique case. He's a self-aware narcissist, and he's also the world-leading researcher on narcissism. What's that like, living with someone with that condition?
Fun.
Fun.
For me, it's fun because I grew up with. Actually, I was molded to be with him. My parents were psychopath narcissist, cerebral narcissist, and I had a sibling who was severe sadist, masochist.
Uh-huh.
She was the golden child, while I was the scapegoat. I was the rejected one, always to blame, always to do things for them, the little servant, little because I'm short. But I did great and many things for them. While I was exiting from my family, from abusive relationship, he was exiting from his own inflicted traumas because he found out that he was the one who was responsible for what had happened to him.
All gaslighting starts from the need to control, the need to control the other. And one way of controlling the other is becoming a rock of stability and predictability in a world that is totally uncertain. So you first create the uncertainty, you enhance it, you amplify it, the uncertainty, and then the other person clings to you because you are like a rock in a stormy sea. The other person knows things about herself, knows things about the world, has beliefs, has friends, has, you know, and then you remove them one by one. You remove her friends, you isolate her socially. Then you remove her family. Then you begin to challenge her knowledge about herself. So you challenge and destabilize, undermine her beliefs about herself, her beliefs about the world. Finally, she's left with nothing except you. You're always there. You're always there to comfort her, to offer interpretations, to suggest ways out, to devise strategies together. So you're always there. You become a rock of stability, predictability, friendship, empathy. In a sea, growing dark sea, frightening sea, surrealistic sea of uncertainty. That is ambient abuse. Mm-hmm. That is gaslighting.
So the play came around after I did some research into The Archers, their domestic abuse storyline. It ran for 3 years, and it focused on the characters of Rob and Helen. And over the 3 years, it showed the sort of drip effect of what Rob was doing to Helen. And it was so incredibly well done and so incredibly subtle. And it got a lot of publicity. It got a lot of people talking about the subject of coercive control.
You can't take narcissism out of the narcissist, because the narcissist is his narcissism.
So what is your advice for women who've experienced emotional abuse, control, manipulation? What's your advice to them?
Leave,
and there's nothing else?
Nothing else. Leave.
Mm-hmm.
The abuse is not a type of behavior amenable to psychological intervention.
People forget to think. For them it's much easier to live the lives that are expected by their friends, colleagues, mothers, fathers, teachers, whoever, the society. You know, it's easier, like, just to obey. What about employing your senses? What about knowing and learning about your environment?
So the name of the play came up a lot in interviews when I'd asked, well, why did you stay? What sort of words did you use? Things like soulmate, life partner, we're meant to be together, that sort of thing. It's one of those cringe words, I think. I think it's used in a very controlling way, like, no, we're soulmates, we're meant to be together, this is how it's meant to be. And it just reminds me of the word as well, checkmate, as if you're that's you stuck, there's no way out, this is your destiny. And I don't think there's anything empowering about that. I think a lot of young men and women should be encouraged to believe that, no, not necessarily one person for all. If someone's acting like this, you're not automatically soulmates and, you know, that's the bottom line and you have to deal with it. It's just one of those things that came up an awful lot, and it just feels to me very significant in the overall theme of the play.